It is Thursday the 15th of April. It is 9:30 and this is the Cat's Whiskers podcast and we are live. Hello, good evening and welcome to the Cat's Whiskers podcast. My name is Tina Taylor and it's probably been about 18 months since I last did this. So I'm probably going to press a button wrong somewhere along the way, but hopefully the three guys I'm going to talk to tonight are going to save me in some fashion or form. So I am joined tonight by Paul Balm.
Hello.
Antoine Marie-Jeanne.
Good evening.
And from the Manchester Storm commentary team, we have our guest a guest appearance tonight from Simon Harris.
Hello there.
Hello. Good evening, Simon. How are we after tonight's game? Have you finished throwing mugs and plates and everything around your room?
Yeah. The dog's cowering in a corner.
Well,
that's frustrating.
I can imagine. So if you want to get in touch with us tonight while we are on the air, then please do so. Best way to do that is via Twitter. Antoine is manning that particular station. It's at Cat's Whiskers TV. And you use a hashtag if you want, chuck in a hashtag Elite Series, why not? That's what everybody else is doing right now. That's what all the cool kids are doing. So, first of all, Simon, you and I have met at once, I believe, when myself and Jono came over to the Storm Shelter. And I think we sort of, barnstormed our way onto your podcast 1 week. So you were formerly of the Manchester Storm podcast, The Forecast. What happened that you made the jump from podcast to commentary?
Oh, it's kind of just being the guy that turned up a lot. To be honest, my resume doesn't really bode well for me to be on there. I mean, if you look tonight, you got the two pros on there. Seth Bennett's on there, BBC commentator. But yeah, the move across, we just got asked, I think it was by Neil Russell initially, to come in and start doing in-house commentary. And we did, and it just seems to have stuck. It's been really enjoyable. A bit nerve-wracking at first. Still is at times, but I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, well, it kind of leads me on to the next sort of question that I had for you. I mean, what was it sort of been like going to the NIC, in these COVID-affected times? And, you're in the bubble, but you're not in the bubble.
Yeah, we're all like, there's like separate bubbles, if it were. You have different zones, so I think I'm in the amber zone, it's called, and you have to go through your entrance. You get your temperature scanned. You have to pass the there's an app, you have to say whether you've been coughing and a spluttering in the last 24 hours and what have you, and then you get accepted. So it's all face masks. It's all well done, really, what you'd expect, and kind of like what you'd be used to after about a year of this COVID stuff now. But interesting to see the behind the curtain and the bowels of the NIC, really. We get to see the steps and stuff that no one gets to use. Really interesting.
Right. Okay. So we'll move on to we'll sort of look at both of our respective teams' performances. So I'll give you a rest for a minute, Simon. We'll talk Panthers for a couple of minutes. So Paul, just looking back on the results that Panthers have had at this halfway point, it's not great, is it?
Why did you come to me about that?
I'm challenging you. I mean, last time you and I were on a podcast together, you weren't allowed to be negative. So I'm just seeing if you're carrying it on.
Are you allowing me to be negative?
I'm allowing you to give your honest opinion.
Well, let's face it, that means I'm going to be negative then, doesn't it? Okay, right. Let's face it. Where do you start with that Sheffield game last Saturday? I mean, that was...
It happened, let's move on.
Yeah.
Let's not talk about that. It was terrible.
Yeah, it's just one of them things, isn't it? But, I mean, it's just one of them things where you just sat there and you just thought, is this really happening? And then you thought, yeah, of course it is. It's us and Sheffield, isn't it? I mean, who knows? I mean, we now know that, well, Ben Bounds was either ill or had an upper body injury, depending on which of the Panthers releases you read or you listen to. And there was something wrong there. But at the end of the day, and Wallace did, after in the interview, Wallace did seem to put, some of the emphasis on that being, you know, why they lost. But, you know, it wasn't his fault. The defence just weren't there in front of him at all. And then, yeah, moving on swiftly. I mean, you can argue we won the second and third periods, but, you know, it's over three periods that the result actually comes from. Against Blaze, I thought, you know, it was a continuation against that. And to be honest, for a lot of the time last night, it was the same again, you know, until we, you know, we actually finally scored that goal. But, you know, I think we've scored one goal in the first period of a game. So, I mean, this is something maybe Simon can answer, because it's something that we always seem to be the people getting interviewed in the second period. Is that because the interview the team that's winning at the end of the first?
Not normally. No, it'll be Luke, the EIHL media manager. It's him that picks them. And it's like you say, it don't have to be necessarily winning, but he might pick the brighter of the two teams. So, you know,
usually,
normally that way.
No, there's not a lot that's been bright about us so far.
Well, I mean, to be fair,
had the hoodoo over Storm, haven't you?
Well, it's nice to have a hoodoo over somebody. It's nice to have a hoodoo over somebody, quite frankly. And I mean, yeah, I think we possibly mentioned something similar to this in one of our WhatsApp groups.
That's where I stole it from.
Yeah, yeah. but you know, who from the Panthers team is going to want to get interviewed in that Sheffield game? I mean, nobody's going to want to talk about that, are they?
If you just bear with me, I'm just buying me 50-50 tickets because they've been moaning about it on Twitter, saying it's not been published enough. So there you go, 50-50 raffle still available until 10 p.m. So if you're listening to this live, you've got 23 minutes. I don't really want to talk. Honestly, I don't really want to talk about it. I really
don't.
Why
are you coming on a podcast then?
No, not well. I'm quite happy to speak about Sunday, and I'm quite happy to speak about last night. But Saturday was,
yeah.
Yeah,
it
I mean,
hurt. It hurt a lot, and you know, for this being a, I mean, in all in effect, it's a GB warm up camp. However, I said last week, or the week before, that I've surprised myself how much I've got invested in the game. As soon as the game started, that was it. I was in it.
Yeah.
And you know, this is our team, the Nottingham Panthers. This is my team that I'm watching. And I'm heavily invested, and I want to see us do well. Don't get me wrong, I don't expect us to go 100% wins throughout a season. Nobody will ever say that. But then time and time again, we come up against those guys and they absolutely humble us. And they did it again on Saturday, and I just don't know what it is. It's obviously, are we scared of playing them, or are Sheffield more up for playing us than we are them? But we just weren't at the races at all. And I know it started to get better second period and third period, but how much of that was down to Sheffield taking the foot off compared to us actually, you know, doing anything of note? It hurt. And I drank myself to sleep that night.
Horlicks, I hope.
there might have been some rum involved.
Yeah, there very well might have been some rum involved. I mean, I'll be honest. I mean, I like to try and be a positive person. You know me. I've got a bit of sunshine about me, or at least I like to think so. But taking the positive out of that Sheffield game is a bit of a hard slog, quite frankly. And it is quite interesting. I mean, the only thing I can really put towards what Ant has just said in terms of, you know, what is it about Sheffield is, I think they've got, you know, they've got a fair few familiar faces Let's not underestimate, you know, the fact that they've got somebody like Jason Hewitt playing on the team, because, you know, he was a part of that Steelers organisation for a long time, and he knows what it means as a Sheffield Steelers player to beat the Nottingham Panthers. So, you know, somebody, something like that, you know, can infect a dressing room, you know, the very same way that a losing streak against them, you know, can do the same. You know, so you know, our guys are, you know, well aware of what our record is like against, you know, against them. So, you know, it's a really odd one, really odd one. Just move on to the Blaze game, just for a couple of minutes. It was almost a kind of here we go again, with us going 2-0 down in the first period. You know, we sort of, it was nice that we didn't concede three in the first couple of minutes. Don't get me wrong. But conceding two, you know, before there was a response in the second period, that was, you know, that was a little bit of a almost deja vu sort of creeping in. But I do have to give just a mention to the lovely short-handed goal from Keck. You've got to admire that kind of determination. You know, the shot was really good. So,
it was superb.
Yeah, I think there'll be a few lining up to try and sign Keck, yeah, to be honest with you.
Yeah, definitely. So, if Danny Stewart's already not got his contract waving in front of his face for next season, then
Well, I'll tell you what. We'll just, as you've come in with that, Simon, we'll sort of jump around. You know, with the, well, I say the plan wasn't really a plan. I took an agenda, I screwed it up, threw it over my shoulder. you've just mentioned that Kex, you know, caught your eye, interesting player. Mm-hmm. Coventry should be signing him. So I'll sort of throw it open to all of you. We'll sort of take him aside for a second. Is there anybody else from another team that has impressed you or surprised you? And I'll let you have the first dibs on that one, Simon.
There's that Alden that's playing for the Steelers, but we already know he's not coming back. He's signed in Switzerland, so that makes it easier to say, because he's not going to terrorise all of us next year. But I just like him. You know, his body movement, the puck seems to just stick to his stick. And just his decision making is like second to none. So far, him from another team, you know, I like some of the guys we got on our own team, but it was to pick.
We'll come on to that. Yeah, in a second.
If it was to pick one player from another team apart from Keck, it'd be him.
Mm. Ant, anybody that's particularly caught your eye from another team?
Liam Keck.
Yeah, all right. That's kind of cheating. I'm not sure I'm going to allow that one.
It's hard to be honest, because obviously I've watched us play Sheffield, Coventry, and Manchester twice, and I've watched, apart from last week's game against Manchester, I've watched all the opposition teams. You know, have the better of us, to be fair, and all the players look good. But then I used my free, in quotation marks, pass to watch the Blaze Steelers game on Tuesday. It was Tuesday, wasn't it? Yeah. And again, it's. I have to say, Jason Hewitt, he does not look out of place in this Elite Series at all. No, well. I know I've cheated a little bit, and I've gone for two, you know, well-known players for us. But you've already talked about Keck, and he's the man for me. He's got a funny name, which I kind of, you know, you kind of remember.
Yeah, it's hard not to laugh when you say his name.
You have no idea how much we laugh when we heard who you'd signed as your goalie.
Oh yeah, we had to find out how to pronounce that.
Paul, any contributions from other teams, players that have stood out to you?
To be honest, I've lost interest in games very quickly, so it is quite difficult so far.
You're also gloomy.
Have you not listened to this before? But I mean, one of the I'm quite another name I'll throw into the mix. I'm quite impressed with Fortier for Storm. Yeah. Quite like him. Say Keck. Yeah. Shane Owen's irritatingly good at the moment. But yeah, but that's pretty much it, really. And yeah.
Well, I'll chuck my hat into the ring. That's it. That's the phrase I was looking for. I've actually been enjoying watching Ben Churchfield. The emergence of the need for him to, step up, basically, because the number one netminder that Steelers have signed, they broke him. they broke him in one game. Is that there has to be a certain irony to us breaking a Steelers netminder, but I'll leave that just there. But yeah, I think you anybody who listens to this podcast at all regularly knows how much I like to champion young Brits and goalies. I've got just inexplicable goalie love, and so yeah, he's apart from being in a Steelers shirt, he's ticking a few boxes there, and I think hats off to the lad. Absolutely, I think he's done really well.
We want to watch going down the line, won't he? To see after this tournament, if he gets much ice time, he could emerge somewhere else, but we'll see.
Yeah. Now, while we're just talking about goalies, I just want to talk about just something that puzzles me, and I'm sure we've discussed it before. We'll probably discuss it again. So, from a Panthers perspective, Jackson Whistle is doing the business, bless him. Now, Jackson Whistle is probably getting an increased amount of ice time due to the aforementioned injury/illness to Ben Bounce. And he's doing fantastic. It just sort of begs the question, why did we protect Whistle but trade up for Bounds? I cannot get my head around it. I just cannot. It's great, having two fantastic netminders, but you've got the GB number one and two. So, essentially. And it just doesn't make any sense to me. Paul, Ant, you got any thoughts on that?
It doesn't make any great deal of sense to me either. I didn't think it did, especially at the time. I think it was an interesting move for us. I don't really understand it. One of the things I think I'd heard in the past, my memory's like, was that Whistle has said in the past that, he doesn't necessarily want a huge number of games, so maybe he was happy to be the number two. But he's also been, he's been one of the few positives that we've been able to take so far.
Yeah. I had to put that in there just as a sort of conversation point. So aside from Whistle, who's doing the business on the Panthers team? Straight away, I'm going to take Cangelosi out of the conversation, because I think well, I'll tell you what, Simon, I'll let you talk about it, because this is not your team we're discussing at the minute. So from a non-Panthers fan perspective, just sort of give us your particular points.
If it was to do it as like an overall, if it was to summarise the Panthers, they seem kind of mechanical, whereas it's like you got the Blaze and the Steelers look kind of fluid going forward. I don't know whether you guys agree with that or not. It just seems like it's drilled. There doesn't seem any spontaneity. And then you get to Cangelosi, and he seems to have that out of the bunch. He seems to be the one that's trying to carve something out. So perhaps that's why I'm noticing him more. Your eye catches those kind of players. So he certainly seems to be working hard and what have you. So apart from him, and you just mentioned Whistle, who seems to be, one of the standout keepers of the series so far, there's not much else, catching the eye at the moment, but I'm sure it'll come. You'll probably be a slow burning team. You know, you only have to be in form. But that's, what is it, 2 more weeks? We've only just over halfway, so there's plenty of time to go. But so far, yeah, Cangelosi is the easy pick of the out skaters.
Well, yeah, I mean, you say slow burning team in a, you know, in a small series, short series such as this. it's kind of a bit of a problem. But I can't remember if it was you know, a commentary with yourselves or another team. But I can remember watching somebody's commentary who said, you know, you've only got to be good in the semi final, really, because you've got to get, yeah, everybody's got to pass to the semi final, so you've only got to be good in that, really. It just depends who you get when you get there.
Yeah, and you can't just switch it on and off. You know that. You need to be in the form like the 2-3 games before that. So you've got a few more games yet, that hopefully something spices up.
Now, Paul, I'm going to come to you actually, and I'm going to give you the opportunity to talk about.
You're going to be negative again, aren't
you? No, I'm going to give you the opportunity to talk about a couple of players who we were discussing. I think just after the game had started yesterday, who have actually made themselves more noticeable.
I think I know who you might mean.
Yeah, possibly.
Are we talking about May and Deneen?
Yes, I think we might be. Yeah. Seeing as though, you know, you mentioned them, and you know, I thought it would be pertinent to talk about them for a little while.
It's nice to see Deneen's turned up. Or at least he did last night. I thought the next time we were going to see his face was on the side of a milk carton.
that's an old school reference.
That's more of an American reference. him and May were really the ones who were coming in with the experience. And, well, Deneen has been invisible, to be honest. And May... Well, when he touched that puck that was going in above his shoulder, it was at that point a very John O'May thing to do, because all he'd seemed to have done, you know, before that was take poor penalties, and to actually for them both to get on the score sheet yesterday was hopefully a sign that, you know, better things are coming. But picking up on Simon's point, he summed us up really well. That, yeah, we do. I'd never thought it this way before. We do look mechanical. There's not that flair there that, you know, that takes it on to the next stage. And what we were crying out for, especially last night, and I think they talked about it on the commentary as well in the game, was it needed somebody to do something, to, you know, grab hold of the game and or the team and just give them that extra smock. And maybe Deneen was, you know, after all I've said, was the one who did it. I mean, he got a gaudy owl last night. So, you know, maybe trying to be positive for once, this is, you know, a step in the, you know, in the right direction, hopefully for both of them, because they're the players that we will, you know, really should be looking towards for that extra spark and that experience.
Ant, any thoughts on, you know, Panthers that have stood out? Not, you know, obviously not people we've already mentioned, you know, because that'd be a bit boring.
I think the Brits generally have played well. I think we talked about last week, the Cat's Whiskers podcast sponsored Liam Stenton. There you go, Paul.
Well done. There you go.
You know, he's impressed. I think I've always liked Lewis Hook from the days when he skated for us in the Champions League.
Oh, and can we have a moment of appreciation for his lovely goal last night? Off of Kelsall's
face-off.
Just to make things
worse.
You're a guest here.
Last week was quite good as well.
Yeah. I was going to apologise to Simon, but, you know, you jumped all over that, so that's lost all sincerity now. But, you know, and there's one lad who, I can't really call him a lad now because he's one of the senior Brits on the team, but He gets a lot of stick, but I think Lakovic has had a really good tournament so far. You know, he's popped up in offensive situations. We know what he can do, you know, defensively. And obviously, you've already mentioned Jackson Whistle's got to be our star man so far.
Yes. Now, I wouldn't disagree with you about Lakowa. He's obviously not putting up the points because, you know, that's not really what Lako does. Lako's contribution is...
He got his goal in the pre-season game,
yeah,
didn't he?
Well, yeah, that's fine. You know, now he can just, you know, set all the people up and, you know, just pop up in the right places and give us a solid penalty kill. You know, crack on. So I don't disagree with that. I'm going to sound like a broken record. Just want to give my customary moment of appreciation for Josh Tetlow. I think he's still got a lot to learn, but I just cannot speak highly enough of the confidence he seems to have gained while, you know, he's had his few games away over on the continent.
What about he's one of them players, Tim, that I've wanted to steal off your lot for years.
We got
and he's doing really well. But yeah, I spotted Josh Tetlow back in about 2015, 16 or whatever it was. And he was like right on the fringe and there's no chance of us getting him now. He looks like he's going to be a solid Panthers player for years to come now.
Well, that works for us. Absolutely. Well, it works for me. I'm quite happy with that. That's just cracking on. So let's just collectively, if we just sort of, because, you know, this is essentially, this tournament has been created to, you know, in order to give the Brits some game time going into the World Championships. So, Simon, I'll come back to you. So your sort of respective Brit pack, you know, whether or not we think they're on the GB long list or anything like that, how do you think your Brits have looked, how do you think your team did in the draft?
We'd start with the draft. I think Finner smashed that. I was quite happy with it. You know, he's got a good mix there of players that know each other and know himself, so I think he did really well there. He obviously didn't have to sign a bouncing net as well, so someone else did that for him. So it was a good trade there. But maybe, yeah, looking at the Brits in our side, obviously, you know, we just touched on Hazeldine there. I think, you know, he's going to come on leaps and bounds. He's going to log big minutes over this series, and obviously he's under contract for us next year, so I think he'll just be playing more and more regular. So it'd be great to see him grow. Dallas, he'll be no doubt in the GB squad. He hasn't played much recently. Got married, had to elope to eventually tie the knot because that got delayed. Not played a lot of hockey, like I say, but game by game improving. Had a really good game tonight as well. Who else we got? We got Josh Batch from Cardiff. Everyone knows what he's like. He's been around forever and he's something like 9 years or something at Cardiff.
Well, somebody's commentary was saying that they thought that he was the oldest player on your team, which I thought was quite interesting.
Yeah, well, he's 30. That's not old to me.
No.
Steve Murphy's 39, so...
God, I completely forgot about Stephen Murphy,
Looking down my notes here, what forgot. No, Kieran Long's also 30.
Ah, there we go.
Takes us nicely to another Brit, even. Yeah, he's doing well. Always has done in a Manchester Storm jersey.
I'd say he's proper picked up where he left off.
After his holiday
in Belfast, hasn't he?
He fits well in Finity's side. Whether that's enough for Pete Russell, I don't know. Maybe we'll give him a chance, you know, because there's no relegation, is there, in this World Championship. So maybe it's the World Championship we do. Put in a wild card. I don't know. Don't know how Pete Russell's thinking, but you know, looking at all the others, let's have a look. So I like the younger ones that we picked up last year. So there's Finlay Ulrich. I think he'll grow if he stays with the organisation going forward. He's a forward. He's looked an handful at times. Didn't really see much of him tonight because I think Ryan's trying to get his top lines firing. But just it's promising. you know, I hate to sound positive because you're all so gloomy, but it's pretty positive for us so far.
Ant, what's your thoughts on our Brits as a whole? I mean, for me personally, I don't feel as positive about the draft as Simon's just been talking about. I don't think we did horrendously. I think we've got some, you know, some nice looking players. You know, some players who have got some, you know, some scope to grow. I think there was maybe, for me personally, I think there was possibly a bit too much focus on Bounds. What do you think?
I think potentially, and obviously, we know Bounds is class. And mm-hmm. and if, in all honesty, he's going to go number one in that draft, regardless of who's trading for him or who's picking, I think. And it's just unfortunate that, you know, he's either got hurt or he's ill. But luckily, we've had Whistle, you know, step forward as mentioned. I think we've missed Garside the last couple of games. I always think, and it's the same saying that we, you know, get said over and over again. If you don't notice a defenseman, generally that means they're doing the job well. And you know he's looked solid, and I'll be looking forward to getting back hopefully tomorrow. And I thought, you know, I've already spoken about, you know, Lacko and a couple of the others, but Kelso's looking a lot, you know, much improved again. And I'll be honest, I like what I've seen from Morgan, you know, in the couple of spurts he's had.
Nearly.
And I will not.
I guess we're not even allowed to. Are we even not even allowed to say the surname? I missed this. I missed this in the last podcast.
I can call him MCP.
Sounds like a car park.
if they're not lining up to sponsor him next season, if he's in a Panthers roster, they're missing out. And I will never have a bad word to say about Bobby Chamberlain. You know, he obviously stepped up on Sunday and tried to get something going. It was Sunday, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. The hug. He tried to get something going for us, but every time he's on the ice, he looks like he wants to bring energy. I will say, I think Ollie's been very quiet. I've kind of expected Ollie to take more of a lead. I don't know what Paul thinks.
Oh, that was seamless, that, wasn't it? I get what you mean, but I mean, he was quiet last night, but again, skating with a cut eyelid that he couldn't see out of the day before, he's gonna do that to you, isn't it? I know. It would be. I was surprised that he wasn't wearing a full face, to be honest. But I mean, yeah, I think he's just not come into games yet. We don't seem to really have settled the lines mainly yet. So he's been moving about, which never helps. But I'd agree with, you know, what you were saying about Chamberlain as well. I remember watching him at Hull years ago when he'd still got the cage. And I looked at him then and I thought, you know, as soon as that cage comes off, somebody, if he keeps playing like that, somebody's going to grab hold of him and hit him, basically. But, you know, the thing that got me out of the Coventry game, to be positive again, was that him having, well, not you can't really call it a fight, but trying to have a fight was the highlight of the first two, probably the first two periods for us. And that really don't bode very well. You know, at all, but yeah, I'll finish now. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, I'll jump in. Bobby Chamberlain, obviously, faced a few times for Storm as well, and I'm in the camp for him as well. He brings something, doesn't he? He brings that fire. He's like, maybe, you know, you were liking Hewitt for the Steelers. He could be that kind of player for another team. He's got, you know, that similar kind of something about him. We wouldn't want to go up against him personally. Anyway,
no. Was it Bobby Chamberlain who ended up having a fight with Mark Leavers one season?
Yes, Yes, that's the one. While he was still wearing his cage.
Yes, I think I remember that. And I remember Leavers looking over to the linesman as if to say, are you going to let me do this? it was a really surreal sort of moment. But, Chamberlain was game, bless him. And yes,
I think he was, 16, 17 at the time. And
something
Yeah. I mean, it shows that he's not afraid to have a go, regardless of, who he's playing against.
Yeah, and you do need that. Say, even if he isn't going around looking for a five, which is, he does bring that energy, and that that sort of energy is one of the things I think we've been missing so far.
Yeah, and he's not had he's sort of been in and out, hasn't he? These first few games, and it's I think. In order to, give the team a bit of a boost, I think he needs to be in for most, if not all, of the next six. Personally,
I mean, what do you think of Griffiths so far?
Interestingly, I think he's, I'll be honest, I think he's underperforming a bit, because I would sort of have half an eye on him when he was playing for Guildford, and he's another player who's, he's got some good, he's got a good hockey brain. He seems to know, where to be. But I don't know. It's almost like he doesn't know what kind of player he is this season. He's not scoring goals, and he's not, there's not a lot of massive physicality going on at the minute in this series. I think that's one thing that is missing a little bit. So yeah, I think I expected a bit more from Griffiths, and possibly from Garrigan as well. I think I expected, I don't know what I expected, but I think I just expected them to stand out in some fashion or form for something. And I think they're sort of getting lost. It's like Ant was saying earlier, if you don't notice a defenseman, it's probably because they're doing their job. Well, if you don't notice a forward, they're probably not. that's the juxtaposition of it, really, isn't it?
It could be that we're just losing interest in games very quickly.
Well, you've already said
3-0 down at the end of the first period, aren't we?
Generally we're sort of looking at games as going, right, okay, so how many are we down by at the moment? get the abacus out and start counting. Do you think it would be possible to pick out players from our teams? This collective virtual table, who we think are possibly going to make it onto the world championship ice. I'll go first. I'll say Pellini's probably, he's gonna go. You're probably looking at Lacko. Bounds if he's fit. Whistle. There's my first offering.
I think they've got to look at Bettridge as well. I mean, yeah, he's been a bit quieter than normal these last few games, but he's got some of the ability to go. If we're saying Lacko is, then I think you've got to say Bettridge as well.
Mm. Siren, I think you've already sort of mentioned a couple of players, GB wise. You mentioned Dallas Earhart, certainly I recall. So who else from your team do you think is sort of making the cut this time around?
I think you have to put Ben Davies in there, wouldn't you? Because he scored that great goal against France, so I think he'd be in there. Not really set it alight for us so far in the series, but he's always there and thereabouts. And Storm have seemed to be a team that seems to be growing and starting to hone in the game so far through the series. So yeah, I think he'll come big towards the end.
Yeah, growing just like Ben Davies's hair.
Yeah, I'm a bit jealous of it.
It's amazing, that hair. That hair's awesome.
Yeah, who else we got on the... Yeah, we mentioned Earhart. I'm not sure about Batch. He's not really performed for us yet, but then, you know, I don't know how deep Pete Russell's defensive core will be, because Swindlers has obviously injured himself, hasn't he? Well,
Batch
we're looking
did a
lovely
Brendan Connolly impression, though. You know.
Oh, it was spectacular. That was spectacular.
Well, I'm just looking down the list now. Who else we got? That's probably about it. I mean, you know, it's the depth of the squad, isn't it? You know, you got Peacock and Haywood, but not really performing or putting up points yet for the Storm. But that's not really what they're about, is it? They're more of a grinder for us at the moment. But those are the ones that have popped out. Ben Davis, I've always wanted in a Storm jersey, is another one that I'd have liked to have stealed. So it's great to have. You know, these few weeks.
About Lake.
Watching him. Lake, yeah. Good point, you know. Just look, going down my notes here, yeah. Good two-way centreman, isn't he? I think he's definitely a Ryan Finity player. He'll be trying to keep hold of his suitcase at the end of this tournament, I'm sure. He's got a horrendous moustache, though. He needs to get rid of that. He just really, really doesn't do that. Yeah, it really doesn't do anything for him. Yeah. I just like the grit he's got as well. And he scored a big goal for us in that first game, got the overtime winner and stuff. But yeah, I think he's got to go.
Yeah, if you're a lover of facial hair, just look on the Storm's roster at Ben Lake's Simon Dry. It's, well, what's going
it's
on
bad.
With him, let's face it.
It looks not even like it should be from an early episode of The Bill or something. It's terrible. It's terrible.
Oh, I've literally just gone onto that page and I see what you're talking about. Yeah. It's the bit where there's a bit missing in the middle as well, aren't you? Anyway, we're vastly running out of time.
Yes, yeah.
This is the important stuff now.
Now we're getting down to the nitty-gritty. Absolutely, I couldn't agree more.
We didn't have to come up with a title before we started.
I must ask you a question. And on that bombshell, yes, we are, as Ant has pointed out, we are. Time is beating us, as much fun as we appear to be having right now discussing the moustache of Ben Lake. So, thank you very much for joining us tonight, Simon. It's been lovely having your perspective and your company.
It's good to have a chat.
Absolutely, it's good to talk. Thank you very much to my fellow Cat's Whiskers podcast panelists, Paul Balm.
Thank you very much.
And Antoine Marie-Jeanne.
Yeah, cheers, Tina. Cheers, Simon, for coming on again. Cheers, Paul, and thanks, everybody else. I'll speak to you soon.
It's not the Waltons.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hashtag stay safe.
Thank you very much to you guys for listening, and we will be back next week to have a look at the games that are coming up this weekend. So, yeah, thanks again, and stay safe, and good night, John Boy.